Hello and welcome to Sports 5. I'm Vineet. From flashback into the past, we go roaring into the future at speeds defying logic. We tread back and discover the origins of a monster we call today as the Superbike. These bikes that you see have not descended from heaven. They were made right here on Earth. Probably if you went to an engineering school, you could have designed one yourself. The daring riders who sit on it and throttle into the unknown are no supermen. They're ordinary guys, just like you and me, but with a fetish for speed. You race on Sunday and buy on Monday. And actually, you can buy. You can actually own what you see there. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking about the world's superbike. These bikes come with a 1000cc engine and over 160 raw brake horsepower. They say the highest speed of these bikes depends on what you can take these machines to. It dates back to 1976, where Steve McLaughlin of Santa Ana, California, won the first ever superbike championship. And he did that at Daytona. He rode a BMW. Reg Pridmore of Goleta, California, became the first US superbike champion in 1976. Pridmore rode a Butler and Smith BMW. The Superbike World Championship began in 1988, being open to modified versions of road bike models available to the public. For many years, the formula allowed for machines with 1000cc V-twin engines, principally Ducati, but later Aprilia and Honda, to go up against the 750cc four-cylinders Honda, Yamaha, Kawasaki, and Suzuki. The twins definitely had the advantage, especially where power delivery was concerned, and this explains the proliferation of Ducatis in recent years. Also, the 750s were allowed a lighter weight limit in 2002 to try and even things up a little more. It didn't seem to change the position greatly. Harley Davidson entered the US Superbike arena for the first time in 1994. After suffering through early teething problems, the Harley Davidson VR1000 ridden by Miguel Duhamel led portions of two races last season, Mid-Ohio and Brainerd. But the Harley's best finish was fourth at Brainerd. Harley hopes to become the first US manufacturer to win a US Superbike. However, with this in mind, the 2003 series followed the lead of British Superbike and allowed four-cylinder machines with a maximum capacity of 1000cc. As well as these bikes and the new Ducati 999, the year saw the delayed entry of Carl Fogarty's Foggy Patronas FP1, which has a three-cylinder 900cc engine. From 2004, the teams have to run on Pirelli-controlled tires, even though most had previously been with Michelin or Dunlop. Partly as a result of this ruling, factory teams from the Japanese manufacturers were thin on the ground for a couple of years. But that all changed in 2005, following the lead of 10K Honda a year before. Kawasaki was the first of the Japanese manufacturers to win a US Superbike National. Reg Pridmore won the Pocono Superbike race on August 21, 1977, piloting the racecrafter's Kawasaki KZ1000. It was the fifth round of the 77 series. Kawasaki riders close out the 1977 season with three victories. After Pridmore's win, Steve McLaughlin won at Laguna Seca on September 11th, and Wes Cooley won his first US Superbike race in the closing AMA round at Riverside on October 2nd. In the championship's history, Ferrari's name, along with that of Ducati, is easily the most significant. Over the course of the 1990s, the Englishman was the champion four times, winning 59 races, or virtually twice what anyone else has managed. Honda's Colin Edwards and Ducati's Troy Bayliss were the class of the field in 2002. With Japanese wildcard Makoto Tamada the only other race winner all year. Indeed, in four seasons, Ducati took around three quarters of the wins from a 24 to 26 race championship. And 2003 saw the first World Superbike's clean sweep. Well, that's all we have from the glorious past of the Superbike. I'm Vineet for Sports 5. Goodbye.